He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit. And he's talking about the Father, referring to the Father as the gardener. And he says, the gardener cuts off every branch in me, the true vine, that doesn't bear fruit. While every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean. Now, remember when we went through this particular passage, that word clean is the same Greek word as the word prune. So clean and prune, in this particular passage, they're the same word. Clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. Now, while I was reading this particular passage, I was wondering, all right, what kind of word or what word was he referring to? And now we have to go back a couple of chapters before John 15. It's like a flashback. We're going to do a flashback into John chapter 13. Let's read verses 10 to 11. John 13, verses 10 to 11. And Jesus answered, and he was talking to the disciples, and he says, those who have had a bath need only to wash their feet. Their whole body is already clean, and you are clean. It's the same word in John 15. Clean, prune. And you are clean or prune, though not everyone knew, for he knew who was going to betray him, and that was why he said, not everyone was clean. Now, he's talking about washing, so it's not appropriate to translate that same word into prune. That's why they translated it into clean. Now, in John 15, they're talking about vineyards or the vine and branches being pruned. So it's not appropriate to translate it into clean, right? So you have to translate the same Greek word into prune. So today, we're going to talk about foot washing, because that's what John chapter 13 is all about. Now, I know that when many churches talk about foot washing, it's always the controversy as to whether we were told to do foot washing as a ritual, or as a sacrament, or as part of the service. And most of the discussions, if you go to the internet to try to figure out, all right, what really happened there in John chapter 13, they always launch off into a discussion of whether foot washing is something that we should do now in the modern church. I beg to differ, because that's not the main idea of why Jesus did foot washing. And if we try to understand now why he did the foot washing, we'll understand why we don't need to do it in the service, or as a sacrament among sacramentalist churches, or as an ordinance among evangelical churches. Now let's talk about society back then, in order for us to understand why Jesus did foot washing. First of all, they didn't have paved roads, they didn't have cemented roads, they didn't have, you know, kind of roads that we have. Their roads were more like trails. And even the Roman roads, which were more like cobblestones, all kinds of farm animals would travel through them. And I remember back in the province in the Philippines, when we go to the provinces, which you would call the country, you would walk down trails, and you can't walk around looking up at the trees, right? Because you don't know when you're going to step on it, right? Because you should know. Because same trail that we use for human beings, the same trail that water buffaloes use, and same trail that all other animals use. And so you got to look down, make sure you're not stepping on a landmine. Same thing in Israel. In the Middle East. Probably now in some parts of the Middle East, still the same way. You got to watch where you're stepping. Make sure you don't step on that landmine, because your feet are going to get really dirty real fast. Share the same road. Now, if you've been around the farms and if you've been out in the country, you know what horse manure looks like. Just like the parable of the Good Samaritan, you want to walk the other side of the road. Now, I still remember back in Manila, they don't have laws that you guys have, that we have here, regarding dogs. You know, you keep your dogs on a leash, you keep them inside your house and not outside, and for a good reason. Because early in the morning, they leave a bunch of stuff outside. And we know that because every time I try to do my jogging in the morning, I can't jog like this. I have to go jog like this. And it makes me sick. When I come back home, before I step into the house, I always go like this. I just might have stepped on one I didn't know. You know, to be dry, but still, it sticks to your feet, to your shoes. So, back in Israel, they go through the roads. After a while, they don't have taxis, they didn't have cars, and most of the people didn't have horses. Only the rich can afford horses. Only the rich can afford donkeys. So most of the ordinary people, even the middle class, if they had one, they walked. Paul walked. Did you know that? In his journey to all the different parts of the Mediterranean, in Greece, in present-day Turkey, Rome, and wherever else he went, he walked. That's like walking from Florida to Texas. He walked all the time. That's far. I mean, how would you like to walk from Las Vegas up to Reno? Or even just to LA, how would you like to walk? Right? They walked all the time. And their roads were dirty. Their roads were dirty because of the farm animals. And just imagine, now we kind of want to think that the temple is a very clean place to go to. Just imagine, every day they sacrificed animals, cows, birds, goats, sheep, they sacrificed every day. So just imagine all these people coming in every day, bringing in farm animals every day, going into the temple. So what does the temple look like? Right? What does the temple look like? At least outside, where they have to prepare the animals. And blood just pours out at the altar every day. So, and here we find Jesus and the disciples. It's Passover time. They had just walked, and they go up to the upper room, and the problem is, no one's hosting. Because it's Passover. Everyone in Israel, in Jerusalem, were going to partake of the annual Passover, which means the slaves won't be there to entertain guests. Slaves will be there with the owner of the house who's having his own Passover. And Jesus and the disciples decided to have their own Passover. So who's the host? Jesus was the host. Who's the bond slave? Who's going to wash the feet? They walk into the room, they don't know who's going to wash the feet. All they had was a bowl of water big enough for the feet. It was set there by the servants, but they weren't there to do the washing of the feet because they had their own Passover somewhere else. And so the disciples walk in. And as disciples, if you've ever read the Gospels, they're always arguing. Always arguing. This time they were arguing about who is the greatest. Now, I kind of wonder why they were arguing about who is the greatest. And I think, you know, the circumstances tells us why. Because they walk into the upper room and they look at the bowl of water and the towel and they said, all right. So who among us is going to wash the other disciples' feet? Now, normally, when you walk into a poor family's home, you wash your own feet because they don't have slaves. But if you walked into a rich man's house, they have slaves, so someone else would wash your feet, a bond servant. Now, among the servants, if they had a lot of servants, there's a few servants who are at the lowest rank. The lowest rank of all the servants, the bond slaves, would be the ones to wash the feet. Because that's the dirty work. Dirtier than washing the plates. Or doing the laundry. So they gave it to the lowest rank of bond servants. In this case, they walk in, there's no bond servant. There's no servant. Who's going to wash the feet? I kind of wonder why they couldn't wash their own feet. Some of them were too big. And wanted others to wash their own feet. Now that's a guess for me. I'm just looking at the circumstances, and I was wondering, I was praying to God, so how come? Why would they not wash their own feet? Since they have water, they can wash their own feet, right? How come no one started the custom? No one stepped there at the bowl and started washing his own feet? How come no one did that? So I kind of wonder whether someone else was arguing about, hey, I'm the chief apostle. Like, hey, James and John probably said, no, we're vying for left and right of Jesus. So an argument ensued, and they were fighting about who's the greatest in the kingdom of God, because the greatest one would be right next to Jesus. And here's Jesus' example, or answer, in Luke chapter 22, verses 24 to 30. A dispute also arose among them as to which of them was considered the greatest. Now think about this. This is just at Passover. This is the last supper that Jesus was going to have. Now, of course, no one knew was going to happen that night. Only Jesus did. And Jesus said to them, because they were arguing about who was the greatest among them, he said, the kings of the Gentiles lorded over them, and those who exercised authority over them called themselves benefactors. Now he called them politicians. But you are not to be like that. Instead, the greatest among you should be like the youngest. And the one who rules like the one who serves. Now, who's the greatest in this room? You are? Right. Now, if you are, Jesus says, it's got to be like the youngest. Now, who's the youngest in this room? You are the youngest too? Now, right there. Sandra's pointing down. I'm not the youngest. So the youngest. You got to be like that youngest. That's kind of weird. For us to come from a society and coming out from the world, especially in these societies, they're probably wondering, what on earth is he talking about? They probably heard a lot of times in the past when Jesus would take up a child and say, you've got to be like one of these. So they probably remember that, but some of the disciples were really thick in the head. And the one who rules like the one who serves. Now in this room, who rules? Right? And he says, if you're the one who rules, you've got to be like the one who serves. Now we're beginning to see what the kingdom of God is like. And that's why the title of this message is The Upside Down Kingdom. Because when you go out there, you find organizations and institutions, and they are all like this. It's called a pyramid, right? We're not talking about a pyramidal scheme. Well, most institutions are a pyramid. And where do we find the first pyramids? Where? Egypt, right. And Egypt is a symbol of? In the Old Testament, it's a symbol of sin, right? Right? Now, Jesus begins to talk about his kind of kingdom. Let's continue on in verse 27. For who is greater, the the one who is at the table or the one who serves? The answer is the one who sits at the table. That's from the world's point of view. And then he says, is it not the one who is at the table? But, and Jesus interjects now and says, I am among you as one who serves. You are those who have stood by me in my trials, and I confer on you a different kingdom. I have that word, a different kingdom. Because just as my Father conferred one on me, so that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom and sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And I confer on you a kingdom. So just as the Father conferred on me a kingdom, I'm conferring on you a kingdom. That's a different kind of kingdom. It's upside down. Instead of benefactors, we have servants. And that's a big change for all the disciples back then. And still a big change for us, because most of the time we're so exposed out there that when we come here, we bring in our experience from outside. Right? It's go into John chapter 13, now that we've discussed the background of this particular passage. John chapter 13, verses 1 to 7. Verse 1, it was just before the Passover festival. Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. Now, notice this. Jesus knew what's going to happen, and Jesus knew that he's God. Come down to earth. He knew this authority. He knew he is the kingdom. Next slide. And yet, Jesus loved them. In spite of their faults and weaknesses that he saw for 3.5 years, in spite of them arguing about who's the greatest, in spite of them saying, probably, I'm not going to wash your feet, you wash mine. In spite of Judas, he knew who he knew was going to betray him that same night. He washed their feet, including Judas. Now, you're probably asking, why are we talking about this? It's not even Passover, it's not even Holy Week, it's not even that time of the year. All because we started off with John 15. We want to know what he meant by saying, I have given you my word is as clean. So let's go to the next slide. Verse 3, Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power. So he has all power and authority, and that he had come from God and was returning to God. He knew that without a question. Without a question, he knew. So he got up. That's amazing. He knew that he was God. He knew that he is the king. So, he got up. That doesn't make sense. That doesn't make sense. It's like saying, you're the CEO, you're the president of the company. So, you got up from the meal, took off your outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around your waist. What? Because you're the CEO, because you're the president of the company, you got up, removed your outer clothing, put on a towel, and started washing the feet of your employees. It's amazing that even though he knew all this, and because he knew all this, he got up from the table, removed his outer clothing, put on a towel and started washing the feet of the disciples. It's because he knew his power and his authority. That's the reason why he got down to his knees. That is so amazing. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with a towel that was wrapped around him. He He didn't have his separate towel. He had a towel around him, and he used that to wash or to wipe off the feet of his disciples. Now, remember, the feet of those disciples were dirty. The feet of those disciples were dirty. It's not like our foot washing ceremony. You remove your shoes and it's clean. You just had a bath before coming in. Probably. You just don't wash your feet. You just went to get a pedicure. Right? So that when you remove your shoes, you're smelling nice. You know, it looks nice. And then someone else says, oh, I can do this. I can wash your feet. Well, their feet were like dirty and probably split nails and everything. You know, dirt inside the nails, the toenails. Ugly, dirty, and he washed it. Jesus came from God to become a human being. Jesus was master to become a bond slave. Question is, can we stoop down just like him? That's tough, right? That's tough. That's how upside down this kingdom is. Next one. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, Lord, are you going to wash my feet? And what did Jesus say? Next verse. Jesus replied, you don't realize now I am doing, but later you will understand. I know you don't know what's going on, but hey, just let me. Alright? Just let me. Next verse. And verse 8 says, Peter says, no, he flatly refused. You shall never, never wash my feet. And Jesus answered, well, you don't want it, no part. You got no part with me. If you don't want it, you're not part of me. And then Peter, like he is, impetuous and lacking in understanding. Next verse, he says, well then, not just my feet, but my hands and my head also. I kind of wonder whether that was sarcastic. Oh, if you're going to wash my feet, well, wash my hands, my head, and my hands also. Right? And so what does Jesus have? I'll reply to verse 10. Let's stay there for now. Jesus' response to Peter was one of patience. Let's go back to that patience slide. What's your weakness? I know my weaknesses. Probably my wife can add some of that list. But the question is, are we patient with other people? If God is patient with me, should I not be patient with other people? If God forgave me, should I not forgive other people? Right? That's why we pray, Father, forgive us our sins as we forgive our debtors. If God is patient with us, we ought to be patient with one another. Right? And there is a scripture regarding that. Next slide. Jesus answered, those who have had, now Jesus goes into an explanation of why he's not going to give you a bath. He's just going to wash your feet. He says, those who have had a bath need only to wash their feet, right? Their whole body is already clean, and you are clean. Now he's referring to what he has done to them. He's been teaching them. He's been giving them the word. Remember John 15, he says, it's my word that cleanses you. My word has cleaned you. So you are all clean, though not everyone you. For he knew who was going to betray him, and that was why he said, not everyone was clean. He's referring to Judas. Next slide. Clean, once again, is equal to prune. But not Judas. He was not pruned. He was not clean at this particular time. Jesus washed his feet. And the other amazing thing is, he shared his meal with Judas. Wow. Judas himself had communion. Judas himself had the Lord Supper. Next slide. You call me teacher, verse 13, and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. I am Lord. I am teacher. Now I am God from heaven. Come down to earth and be with you. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. So Jesus is saying, it's an example. It's not an example just to make a point. It's an example to follow. It's an example to follow. But what are we supposed to do in following him? Very truly I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. As messengers here in the church, we're not greater than God. He is Lord of this church. Right? He is master and teacher. He is the shepherd. He is the great shepherd. He is the pastor. We're no greater than him. And nor is the messenger, I read that already. Verse 17. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. Here's the thing, next slide. Our master washed the servant's feet. And the servants should wash each other's feet. See, we're not masters. We're all servants. Although Jesus said in chapter 15 that he no longer calls us servants. He says, we're all friends. Because he reveals to us his secrets. Question is, are we servants who are too high to serve? Or are we servants who are willing to stoop down and wash each other's feet? Now, we don't have dirty robes. We have dirty shoes. Right? And I know when we first came here to the U.S., I looked at the carpet and said, and we were living in my sister's house, and they removed their shoes. Upon entering the house, I said, well, we gotta remove our shoes, because we're staying with someone else. So we removed our shoes. Now, when we moved to our own apartment, I looked at the carpet and said, man, you know what? If we tracked our shoes inside, this carpet's gonna get dirty real quick. And back in the Philippines, we didn't have carpet. So we walked in with our shoes, we walked in with our flip-flops and, you know, women's sandals, you know, we just walked in. Because our flooring, because of the climate, we can't have carpet. It rots. And there are four things that we can learn from here. First lesson. The lesson of humility. We need to be humble to one another. In Ephesians 4, chapter 2 says that. It's a command. Be humble one another. Next lesson. Servanthood. We need to serve one another. And that's in Galatians chapter 5, verse 15. Next. Hospitality. We need to be hospitable. That's something that's lacking in our culture, in our society. We need to be hospitable to one another. 1 Peter 4:9. And then the last one is we need to love one another. And that is the new commandment. In John chapter 13, verse 34. Now, the Equiper, which is a newsletter coming from GCI, they came up with they mentioned a book written by Tom and Joni Schultz. The title of the book is Why Nobody Wants to Go to Church Anymore. And there are four points that they give out as something that we need to do as churches. Because a lot of people don't want to go to church anymore. And the first, there are two points I'd like to highlight today. And the first one is radical hospitality. And they describe it like this. This means being like Jesus, the friend of sinners who welcomed everyone, drawing them to himself with unconditional love. That's one of the things we need to do. Radical hospitality. And the next one, the second point from that book, is genuine humility. Not just fake, not fake humility, but genuine humility. People hunger for a community that says, hey, we're in this together, we all struggle, we're not perfect, no one has all the answers, we're all trying to know and follow Jesus together. And I just want to welcome all those who are you have become new parts of this congregation because, you know, the Lord led you over here. And I hope that we can show you that, you know, no one's perfect here. We're all in this together. this is a place where imperfect people are perfectly known.